This week, we are reviewing the dominant grape varietal found in the largest white wine producing region in all of Italy. And in this week's tip of the week, we're going to cover the four ways that you can quickly chill your wine at home. All of that coming up next. Hello and welcome to Wine This Week with Scott Leake. This week we are in northern Italy in the region of the Veneto, which we covered this region a little bit a few weeks ago in the episode on Corvina, covering the region of Valpolicella. Right next to Valpolicella is a region called Soave, and we're going to be discussing one of the primary varietals found here this week. Now when you look at the word, you maybe think this is pronounced Soave or Soave, but to help you remember and never ever again forget how to pronounce it, it sounds exactly like this. Rico. Soave. Yeah, that's as bad as I remember too. The wines of Soave tend to be predominantly or exclusively from the grape Garganega. Now, the wine that we're having today is 100% Garganega. Sometimes it is blended in Soave with Trebbiano. It also might have a little bit of Chardonnay in it at times. But for the most part, Garganega is fairly synonymous with the region of Soave. And just like when we covered in the Corvina episode on Valpolicella, which I would encourage you to go back and review again, because in that tip of the week, I talked a lot about all the different terms on Italian labels, the DOC, DOCG, Classico, Reserva, Superioria, all that. So if you want a really refresher on that or didn't see it, go back and watch that episode. Soave DOC is kind of a flat-lying area. It's actually massive. It is the largest white wine producing region in Italy. But up on the hills is the heartland area, what is known as Soave Classico DOC. There's also another Soave that you might find if you're looking for one, which would be the Soave Superiori DOCG, which is yet another higher classification. It's going to get that because of lower yield requirements and thus maybe producing higher quality wines, maybe a little bit higher alcohol as well. But today we're going to be reviewing a Soave Classico DOC. What we know about these styles of wine is that they tend to be very food friendly. They're going to be dry, crisp, bright acidity, have some floral notes, maybe some citrus, some almond. And these are really great to drink young and fresh. This is a 2019. I'm excited to try it. This week's wine is the Soave Classico 2019 from Inama. Don't fear the screw cap. Nothing wrong with the screw cap wine. On the color, it is a pretty pale straw color. It's lovely. Give you guys a little look at it there. Great color on it, but fairly pale yellow. Ooh. Nice nose. I could smell this all day. So everything I've read about Soave is that it's going to be a very floral wine, and I'm certainly getting some kind of white flowers, jasmine or chamomile maybe. There's some pear and green apple. Maybe a little bit of lemon, some type of citrus. It smells great. Let's give it a try. It's a nice wine. It's very dry, good acidity. It's actually not quite as high acidity as I thought. Nope. See, now I'm about to spit all over the place. I'm changing my mind. Yep. High acidity, good, bright, clean, and refreshing. At 12% alcohol, I'm a little surprised because I'm feeling a little bit more heat on the finish than I would have expected at 12%. I don't dislike it, just noting. Yeah, not very sweet. I'm going to call this a pretty dry wine. The body's kind of, this one's I'd call a medium finish. I didn't mean finish there. Medium body. Actually, it is a medium finish too. There's a little weight on it. It's not too thin. Good weight and body on the wine as well. As far as the flavors go, kind of medium intensity on the flavors, and I'm getting all those things that I smelled as well. So I'd say more of a yellow apple than a green apple on this. I'm getting some pear, I'm getting some lemon. There's a little bit of almond on the finish, which is kind of nice. And that's usually something you might associate with a Soave that's maybe a little bit aged, but I'm getting a little bit of it here. The one thing that I really like about this is that it reminds me a bit of Chablis, in that there's some nice minerality on this as well. There's this kind of whetstone minerality that I really like. And in Soave Classico in particular, the hills have a lot of black volcanic rocks, and so the soil in that region is going to produce more minerality in the wines than maybe the low-lying flat areas of just the Soave DOC. So really liking all the elements coming together here. This has got a lot of good structure to it. It's a good wine. I'm really digging this. This is this is a wine I could probably slam the whole glass of this pretty quickly. All right, I'm gonna say, in evaluating this wine, it's got pretty good balance. The acidity and the minerality are a little bit more predominant than the fruit is. The fruit's there and it's nice and it's really pleasant, but I'm not gonna give it just like 100% score on the balance. The length is pretty good. There's a good finish on this. It's not crazy long, but a good medium finish. And the intensity is kind of a nice medium intensity on everything as well. And same with complexity. So it doesn't wow in any one category, but it does well in every category as well. So I'm gonna call this a 6.5 point wine on my 10 point scale. And as far as food and wine pairings go, I hate to sound like a broken record, but man, this is really versatile. I'm thinking any type of Italian cuisine that involves risotto or shellfish, whitefish, grilled vegetable salads. There's a lot of things that this is going to work well with. This has all the elements you're looking for in great food pairings. It is now week 3 of our 3-part series on wine temperatures. So 2 weeks ago, I talked about why temperature matters with your wine. Last week, we talked about what to do when a restaurant doesn't know what it's doing and serves you a bottle of wine that's too warm and how to solve that. This week, we're going to talk about what you can do at home when you need to chill wine really quickly. Usually, this is going to be the case with white wine or sparkling wines, but if you're going to have a Beaujolais like we did last week and you want to chill that really quickly, some of these tips are going to work for that too. So we're going to talk about 2 things you can do to chill a glass really quickly and 2 things you can do to chill the entire bottle really quickly. So first off, when you're trying to chill glasses of wine really quickly, oftentimes we think, well, we need to just put the whole bottle in the freezer. But what would be really fast, if you're going to just be drinking you and one other person, go ahead and do your full pour into 2 glasses and just put those 2 glasses in the freezer. And that is going to chill each individual glass a lot more quickly than as you wait for the whole bottle. The second thing you can do, and this often happens when maybe you're about to have a second bottle of the wine for the day, you had a great time, you're like, oh, we should open another one, but oh, we didn't have one cold. Or maybe you had one and it just kind of sat on the counter a little too long and it got a little warm. So it's like, well, I don't want to put ice in the glass. What do I do? Well, in my little makeshift freezer here, I would say keep a baggie or any type of plastic container full of grapes in your freezer and put your frozen grapes in your glass, add some wine, and those frozen grapes are going to be your ice cubes. And what's awesome about this is that, well, wine's made from grapes, so if it's going to impart any flavor, it might impart a little grape flavor, but it's really not going to impart any flavor on it. And as those thaw, they're gonna get the wine chilled nice and quickly like an ice cube would, but they're not going to turn into water and thus dilute your wine. So your wine is not gonna change its flavor at all by doing the grape trick in your glass. If you need to chill a bottle of wine really quickly, put it in a bucket of ice. Now, the problem with doing that is you have the space in between the cubes that is a little bit warmer than the cubes themselves. Better thing to do is to do actually a bucket of ice water. Now, that works pretty well, but there's one step you can go even further to chill it faster, and that is to put ice, water, and salt together. So anyone who lives in the Midwest or the Northeast in the wintertime knows we put salt on our roads and our driveways in the wintertime to help melt the ice. And when you put salt, I'm not going to get into the whole thermodynamics of it, but really quickly, when you put salt in your bucket of ice water, you're actually lowering the temperature at which that ice is going to melt from like 32 degrees down to 15. So you are now getting that bucket of ice water much colder with adding the salt than if you just had plain old ice water. Might get down to about 15 degrees Fahrenheit. And if you even maybe give that bottle a spin every minute or two while it's in that bucket of salty ice water, that is probably gonna get chilled in 10 minutes or less. So that is actually probably the fastest way to chill a bottle of wine. The other thing you can do, maybe you don't have enough ice at home, the other thing you can do is you can take a paper towel or kitchen towel, get it soaking wet, and put this in the freezer like this. And then when it's done, you unpeel it, and you are going to have a really chilled bottle of wine by wrapping it in a wet paper towel or dish towel first, and then putting that in the freezer. It is going to do a better job of taking the moisture from the towel and getting the entire surface of this much colder than if you just stick it in there and rely on all the air temperature in the freezer to chill it. It's almost like creating a sheet of ice around it and then chilling it. So those are my four top recommended ways to quickly chill wine at home when you want to get it done in 5, 10, maybe 15 minutes using any of those tricks, as opposed to just putting it in the freezer that might take a good 45 minutes to an hour. Hopefully this helps you enjoy your wine at the proper, or shall I say, at your preferred temperature much more easily. Thank you for watching another episode of Wine This Week. I hope you enjoyed it, and if so, please like and subscribe. Join me next week as we move on to one of the most challenging names to pronounce in all of wine varietals, Gewürztraminer. Until then, keep trying new wines, and as always, cheers.